This video is brought to you by Captivating History. In the annals of the notoriously violent Viking history, very few warriors necessitate superlatives. Tales of unspeakable savagery set them apart from their fellow brutes. One such figure is Ivar the Boneless. The legend's son, Ragnar Lothbrok, and his second wife Aslaug, Ivar commanded the great heathen army. The origins of his moniker, Boneless, are unknown. Since there is no historical record of how it came, historians speculate and interpret it differently. One theory claims that Ivar must have had a genetic disease that rendered him disabled. This disability could have been osteogenesis imperfecta or Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. Because of his physical shortcomings, some say he could not partake in the battles but made up for any weaknesses with his witty and shrewd mind. Other interpretations define him as a great warrior on the battlefield. In the literary works of the Ragnar saga, Ivar was born with deformities, probably in the early 800s. Aslaug warned Ragnar that if he did not resist his temptations for 3 days, their child would pay the price for their misdeed. Ragnar failed to contain himself and forced himself on her, which led to the conception of a cursed child. Some theories suggest that Ivar was impotent, never married, and probably died without a natural heir, and thus earned the brash nickname. Other sources claim that he was fierce in battle and moved with a relentless pace and seething vigor. All these stories are nothing more than speculations and guesswork. What is known about him is that he was a warlord and a leader of rare tactical prowess. As merciless as he was no less skillful, perceptive, and politically savvy. Some stories mention that a seer foretold Ragnar of his offspring. Not being able to shake off the prediction, Ragnar became obsessed with the fate of his sons. He decided to kill Ivar, but could not go through with his plan. Finally, Ivar went into a self-imposed exile. In the early 800s, the Viking Age was well underway. The Norse invasions were putting strain on the Anglo-Saxon states. The Anglo-Saxon Heptarchy consisted of East Anglia, Essex, Kent, Mercia, Northumbria, Sussex, and Wessex. The Viking opposition captured and killed Ragnar during his attack on Northumbria. Although there is little evidence of this, some sources claim that the Northumbrian king cast Ragnar into a pit of snakes. The news spread throughout the land and served as a call to arms to Norse warriors. Ivar joined forces with his brothers Halfdan and Uba and gave birth to the great heathen army. In mainstream culture, the Vikings are often portrayed as filthy, grimy, and unpleasant people. The unpleasant part may have been true to some extent, but they were certainly cleaner and tidier than we give them credit for. Stereotypes have deluded the Vikings to ruthless barbarians, a term initially used by Greco-Roman culture to identify foreigners. Modern culture thinks of Vikings as tall and grumpy individuals wearing horned helmets. Thanks to Wagner operas, the association with helmets probably occurred during the latter half of the 19th century. As for their physical attributes, they were not tall and imposing. Archaeological data estimates that they were short and muscular, mostly because they continuously engaged in physical labor. Therefore, before discussing the Vikings, one should take caution of their flawed modern depiction. You might have been led to believe that the Vikings were a Scandinavian people or tribe, another narrative that is entirely divorced from reality. The word Viking referred to the people who went pillaging, plundering, and looting. An increasing number of bands and groups of Scandinavian marauders emerged in Western Europe around the time, so people conflate the term Viking with Norse and Dane. Over the years, Viking became synonymous with Norse raiders and barbarians. However, there is some truth to the warped image of the Vikings. They were sadistic and often opted for brute force. Like in 865, when Ivar the Boneless and his brothers led their army into the Anglo-Saxon territories. After landing in East Anglia, the Norsemen made their way to Northumbria and captured York in 866. The scope and objective of this invasion were unprecedented, because the Vikings did not come to loot and plunder. They came to avenge the death of their former leader and occupy the British Isles. The size and scale of the invasion shook the English, who were used to raiding parties coming from the north that used to pillage and ransack their villages and towns. However, this was a unique situation that called for joint action. Once the invaders had shown their hand, their intentions were no longer ambiguous to the British, who decided to join forces. The Northumbrian king, Ella, was responsible for killing Ragnar Lothbrok and had engaged in a civil war with King Osbert, who he had usurped on his way to the throne. Once York was lost to the great heathen army, the two men put their differences aside. Now that they had bigger fish to fry, they decided not to quibble in their internal disputes until the foreign threats were quelled. The compromise made little difference to Ivar and his forces as they ran through them, killing King Osbert on the battlefield and taking King Alla prisoner. King Alla did not fare better than his predecessor and was executed for killing Ivar's father. Some historians think that Ivar tortured King Alla to the point of mutilation. The Blood Eagle was one of the Danes' most graphic, violent, and disturbing torture methods. They would draw an eagle on the victim's back, slice it, and pull the skin off, revealing the victim's innards. After prying his ribcage open, they would pull out and spread the lungs, making a symbolic outline of an eagle's wings. With the death of King Alla, the Kingdom of Northumbria was no longer an independent entity. Ivar installed a puppet ruler named Egbert in Northumbria, and the Vikings turned their attention to the Kingdom of Mercia. They spent an entire year raiding the city of Nottingham and eventually broke through the walls. After capturing the city, they butchered the citizens and settled there. The English were vigilant and fully aware of the oncoming menace. By this time, they had realized that the Vikings were a legitimate threat, capable of razing their cities to the ground and executing their kings and nobility. King Burgred of Mercia and King Ethelred I of Wessex allied and advanced toward Nottingham. They outnumbered the Norse armies, so Ivar decided to negotiate a peace settlement and retreat to York. Peace, a desperate hope, as is often the case, it was not to be. The Vikings returned to East Anglia when King Edmund led an army against them. He was captured and ordered to renounce Christ. Edmund did not heed any threats and refused to do so. Ivar and his brother Uba had him tortured and executed, beaten with clubs, tied to a tree, shot with arrows, and finally beheaded. The Vikings had taken over several British territories and had expanded their rule from York to create the state of Danelaw. In this state, Danish laws and customs were observed. These events were responsible for the diffusion and disintegration of the Heptarchy. As the Heptarchy fell apart, a notion of grand unification started to foster in the upper echelons of the society. Over time, the masses began warming up to the idea. The reactionary approach to the Viking invasion served as the bedrock for the United Kingdom of England. In the 870s, the Vikings started their campaign against Alfred in a bid to take over Wessex. Alfred continued to hold off the Norsemen for quite some time. In 878, he won a decisive battle at Edington, and in 886, Alfred reoccupied London and asked his son-in-law to take care of local matters. He then turned his attention towards military and legal reform. When the Vikings had marched against Alfred to conquer Wessex, Ivar was not the invading group and had departed for Dublin. After he vanished from the historical records, he died peacefully in Dublin, sometime around the 870s. The association with Dublin may have more to it than meets the eye. Some historians claim that he and Ymir, founder of the Uí Ymir dynasty in Ireland, were the same individual. It is not a proven fact, but the dates of their adventures are quite similar. Ymir vanished from the records in the 860s, and Ivar the Boneless gained recognition in the British Isles around the same time. In 870, Ivar disappears from the records, and Ymir starts reappearing in them. Furthermore, the year of their respective deaths is also the same, 873. Ymir supposedly died of a sudden and horrible disease. This could also be connected to the nickname of Ivar. In the 850s, he is said to have befriended Olaf the White, the King of Dublin. The major issue with treating Ymir and Ivar as the same individual comes with their conflicting mass appeal. Ymir was loved by his people, whereas Ivar was a sadistic warrior and a cruel leader. However, this does not provide material evidence that they were different individuals, since the impression of a leader may rely on the author's biases. In the Nordic sources, he is depicted as a god with supernatural abilities, whereas in the British sources, he is described as a pagan demon from hell. Recent excavations have revealed that a body in Repton could be the remains of Ivar the Boneless. The body shows two spear wounds in the skull and implies the removal of his genitals. Nearby, the bodies of 249 people, including children, were excavated. In 873, the Great Army was traveling to Repton, and the saga of Ragnar Lothbrok states England as the burial place of Ivar. Ivar is said to have reignited his friendship with Olaf in 870. Around this time, the two of them looted the county of Meath and attempted to conquer the Scottish Isles. For 4 months, Olaf, Ymir, and their Viking companions lay siege to Dumbarton Rock, which belonged to the Kingdom of Alt Cult. they destroyed the citadel and took many hostages. Historians suspect the looting of the settlement and the abolishment of alt-cult dominance on maritime routes as the potential motives of this attack. The site also had considerable strategic value, as the Vikings could use it as a port to leave for the central lowlands of Scotland. After the defeat, Govan became the central location of alt-cult, and their kingdom became known as the Kingdom of Strathclyde. Ivar the Boneless was a vicious king who was just as astute in political matters as he was unforgiving on the battlefield. He was responsible for the unification of three English kingdoms, which collectively constituted the North State of Danelaw. Before the formation of the Great Heathen Army under Ivar the Boneless and his brothers, the Vikings were sacking and looting cities with no end goal in mind. 793 marks the commencement of the Viking Age, which changed the course of English and Scandinavian history forever. While Ivar was not responsible for the first chapter of this era, his achievements with the Great Heathen Army were the turning point of Viking history. The Danes' conquest and colonization of the British Isles helped them retain a foothold in the territories until 1066. At that point, the Norse influence in the area withered out and brought about an end to the Viking Age. To learn more about Ivar the Boneless, check out our book, History of the Vikings, a captivating guide to the Viking Age and feared Norse seafarers such as Ragnar Lothbrok, Ivar the Boneless, Egil Skallagrimson, and more. It's available as an ebook, paperback, and audiobook. Also, grab your free Mythology Bundle ebook while they're still available. All links are in the description. If you enjoyed the video, please hit the like button and subscribe for more videos like this.